Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Steven Spielberg, A Life in Films, by Molly Haskell. Narrated by Johnny Heller, with Joanna Perrin.
Preface. In early 1993, Steven Spielberg is in Krakow filming Schindler's List. By day, he shoots a scene in a work camp. Children are being herded onto trucks for deportation, singing as if on a jolly field trip. A few run away to crouch in cellars and boxes, and when there are no more hiding places, one jumps into a latrine. By night, he is talking via satellite with the crew at Industrial Light and Magic in Northern California, discussing the final editing of Jurassic Park, listening to John Williams's score, maybe fiddling with the elbow of a velociraptor. The juxtaposition, as if dread and anxiety could thus be halved, one film allaying the stress of the other, seems almost inhuman as well as superhuman. In December 2016, Spielberg turned 70. In his eighth decade on Earth, he is still making movies as fast as we can see them. What keeps him going? The answer, or rather the mystery, begins with the outsized fears of a little boy who began biting his nails while still in knee pants. A little boy who was spooked by everything, by the static on the radio, by Disney films, by the tree outside his New Jersey window that turned sinister in a storm, its branches weaving and waving like some otherworldly monster. What makes him unusual is not just the size of the fears, but his manner of hanging on to them. Rather than bury those shaming moments of childhood vulnerability, as most of us do, he nourished their memory, translated them into bold cinematic images, and projected them onto a terrified audience as he had once relieved his own anxiety by terrorizing his younger sisters. So powerful was the urge, and so successful an exorcism, that as a director he would aim for nothing less than whole theaters full of spectators biting their nails or blissed out with shock and awe at close encounters with the paranormal. In the weeks leading up to the 2014 Academy Awards, one of the factoids that newscasters dished out to whet viewer appetites was a statistic on who Oscar winners thanked most. The top two names, according to NBC's Lester Holt, were Steven Spielberg and God, with the latter receiving only 19 mentions to the former's 42. What did this mean? That he has touched more lives and boosted more careers than the Almighty, let alone L.B. Mayer, David Selznick, Irving Thalberg, Lou Wasserman, and assorted agents, parents, and spouses. Or perhaps that the popular populist has simply become a lodestar to would-be filmmakers, like the celestial light in Close Encounters of the Third Kind, or the extraterrestrial pal E.T. Or even that his philanthropic work, like the establishment of the Shoah Foundation, with its archived testimonies from Holocaust survivors, has granted him a transcendent place among mankind's beneficiaries. The output is staggering. His fingerprints are everywhere, as producer as well as director, in video games and television as well as feature films. In his 42 years of making movies, 52 if you count his childhood efforts, the Wunderkind has given more pleasure to more people than any other filmmaker in history. If he hasn't touched every heart and mind with every picture, it's a guarantee that he has touched even the harshest critic with one or two or three. For some, the early movies centering on childhood, Close Encounters and E.T., have never been bettered. For others, Jaws, Raiders of the Lost Ark, and Jurassic Park are the greatest adventure movies ever made. And even their weaker spin-offs and sequels have a way of earning, with time, the revisionist honor of underappreciated gems. For still others, like myself, the later films with their dark edges, Empire of the Sun, Schindler's List, AI, Minority Report, and the melancholy-tinged Catch Me If You Can, give a greater and very different kind of pleasure. Other action movies and franchises may equal or outperform his at the box office, but no filmmaker has combined profits and prestige the way he has, with multiple Oscar nominations and wins, while at the same time having directed, with figures adjusted for inflation, 2 of the top 10 grossing films of all time, E.T., The Extraterrestrial, and Jaws. The box office flops are few, and generally the artistic failures and underperformers go on to recoup their investment in global release or on DVD. Financial success is also part of the story, off-putting to many and a critical liability, but something that has enabled him to follow his conscience into less crowd-pleasing movies and accomplish a great deal as a philanthropist. When Yale University Press came to me with the idea of writing a short biography of Spielberg for its Jewish Lives series, I hesitated for obvious and less obvious reasons. I didn't worry about not being Jewish. Let others do that. I believe strongly that there should be no bars of race, ethnicity, or gender to writing, and I think it's particularly important in the case of Spielberg, for one of his greatest traits has always been a kind of natural ecumenism, a generosity of spirit. He grew up in mostly Gentile suburbs in New Jersey and Arizona, and belatedly found his own path to Judaism, coming to terms with the faith he denied and the insults he'd suffered, but remarkably free of rancor or a retributive agenda. More to the point, I had never been an ardent fan. We both had our blind spots. The problem was Spielberg's blind spots were my C-spots, and vice versa. He readily acknowledged that he had no feeling for European films. He always wanted his films to arrive someplace. But brooding ambiguities, unresolved longings, things left unsaid, and the erotic transactions of men and women are the very things that drew me to movies in the first place. His great subjects, children, adolescents, and genres, science fiction, fantasy, horror, action-adventure, were stay-away zones for me. Even his forays into history were inspirational rather than ironic or fatalistic. The work of a man who favored moral clarity was uncomfortable with shades of gray. Nor was I, nor had I ever been, the adolescent boy whose fears and anxieties were the gnawing, liberating center of his films, who would respond passionately to his oeuvre, resisting with him the ordeal of growing up and moving on. I had been born a different gender and 6 significant years earlier, a war baby as opposed to the boomers of which he, born in 1946, was an entry-level member. Mine was an in-between sensibility. Although I would rebel and make a break for broader pastures, adults were still figures of fascination and respect. I worried more about my biases, my inherent lack of sympathy as a woman, as a person, for the genres in which Spielberg had enjoyed his greatest successes. I was never susceptible to the wonderments of fantasy or the supernatural, whose delights, like the cacophonous thrills of car crashes and train wrecks, belonged to a boy's world. Yes, fangirls, many of you respond to vampires and werewolves and dystopic science fiction, as Twilight and The Hunger Games have demonstrated, and conversely, many men are indifferent to its charms. Still, the fears that Spielberg played with so brilliantly struck me primarily as men's fears of women, of maturity, of sex. Some of us were hard on his early films, so hard that, looking back, I was shocked at the intemperate tone of our reviews. I was a true believer in something more magical than UFOs, a crusader in what would later be called the great age of cinephilia, seeing and reevaluating the glories of the past, rushing to see and talk about exciting new auteuristic films from Europe and America. This sense of peril and a certain foreboding is what we felt when suddenly, somewhere around 1973, the conversation was all about money. Saturation marketing, must-see summer films, the advent of the blockbuster, and then the high drama of the weekend opening and the box office intake. Trying to come to terms with this man, who has had such an outsized influence on our lives, seemed like a worthy challenge. In grappling with Spielberg, I would be confronting my own resistance. Moreover, there were many Spielberg films that I did love and looked forward to seeing again, and came to admire even more the second or third time around. And the man has worn extraordinarily well. Naysayers have been turned into yay-sayers as critics have come to appreciate the sheer versatility of his movie-making skills. He's a deft deployer of the latest in CGI techniques and video, but is a deep-in-his-bones lover of the look and texture of classic film. If he and George Lucas were responsible for catapulting science fiction into the big-budget stratosphere, Spielberg's movies displayed a feeling lacking in the efforts of many of his followers for actual human beings. His instincts, the way his genre and period films resonate with present-day anxieties, have proved so unerring as to be uncanny. There is nothing ironic or cutting-edge about him, and that has proved refreshing. His history epics are told in straightforward fashion and celebrate an old-fashioned sense of virtue, transmitting the best of a tradition we've come to appreciate in its absence. Oddly enough, there were certain common points between Spielberg and me. We were both squares come to the big city, products of 50s suburban America, repressed in different ways, looking for something. If we weren't exactly apolitical, neither of us was inflamed by radical activities or attitudes. Spielberg's Middle America was not the circle of hell favored by most filmmakers, nor was he biased against the establishment. So when his films did become more concerned with human carelessness and criminality, the darkness was earned. Would Spielberg speak to me? I made inquiries. No, his assistant emailed me. He had a policy of not granting interviews to biographers. It was true he hadn't given an interview to Joseph McBride, who seems to have talked to everybody else, and to whose superb biography I am deeply indebted. Still, I felt stung, a little red-faced, like a girl angling for a date and being rejected. There also may have been a bit of a grudge. While watching clips of Spielberg on YouTube, I came upon one from 1978 where he is speaking with directorial aspirants in a masterclass at the American Film Institute. He looks as young as or younger than his audience members, but has chalked up two monster successes of which they seem quite suspicious. Is he in it for the money? What will he do now? He has said earlier that he is not a director who imposes his style like Orson Welles, but rather a craftsman like Victor Fleming, the studio go-to man for big pictures like The Wizard of Oz and Gone with the Wind. Then, smiling from under his baseball cap, he says, "You just have to have confidence. You can't worry if critics like Andrew Saris and Molly Haskell don't like your movies." I winced. But I also fell a little in love with him at that moment, with his charm and quick-wittedness, his playful faux modesty, and, most erotic to a movie lover, his obvious knowledge of and passion for films. His spurning of me personally came to seem a relief. I'd have been compromised, either through natural sympathy or good manners. I'd have felt inhibited, seduced into his point of view, unable to maintain a critical distance. The sense of personal liking was strong and buoyed me while slogging through massive amounts of material and trying to figure out how to write a short biography of a man still dauntingly alive and around whose career the critical dust was far from settled. I wanted to do justice to the life and the fascinating issue of his Jewishness, denied, then embraced. But because of who he was, everything about me is in my films, and who I was, I needed to tell it through the movies. I take it, as by now, axiomatic that film criticism is personal, never objective or unbiased, and biography can evaluate as well as report. To tell the story of Spielberg through his films is to take into account one's own engagements and the way time and context, politics, world events, other films, alter everything. We and the films age and change. Considerations of box office and marketing and hyperbole recede in time. The glories of art endure.
Chapter 1. Beginnings and the Lost Ark. It's the late 60s and early 70s, the age of Aquarius. America is at war with the communists in Southeast Asia and at war with itself at home. Political agitators turn violent. Plays and movies bristle with drill sergeant language. Counterculture rebels are slashing icons and reinventing genres. But Hollywood, our national coliseum, is missing out on the action, being mired in the mindset and operational mode of the studio system of the 50s. The tremors of change are elsewhere. 100 miles up the Pacific coast at Nicholas Beach, where a motley group of auteur wannabes, film school nerds, and showbiz bohemians hang out and smoke dope and conspire to take over the industry. Their crash pad is a ramshackle house rented by actresses Jennifer Salt and Margot Kidder. Julia and Michael Phillips, producers of the Oscar-winning The Sting, 1973, will buy a neighboring house and host week-long drug-fueled soirees, described in Julia's own gonzo-ish memoir, You'll Never Eat Lunch in This Town Again. The guest list will feature such drop-by celebrities as Robert Redford and Liza Minnelli, and from up the beach, literary lights Joan Didion and John Gregory Dunn. But most of the gang, high on drugs and European movies, are unknown or barely known filmmakers, like Francis Ford Coppola and Marty Scorsese, Paul Schrader and John Milius, and Brian De Palma, George and Marcia Lucas, all film school graduates. Julia casts her beady eye in a rogues gallery of nerds. Slim pickings from a woman's point of view, adding, I wouldn't have gone out with any of them in high school. But the guys, thanks no doubt to the influence of Julia, who is getting through pregnancy with the pharmacopoeia of quaaludes, coke, uppers, and downers, are at least learning to act cool and get laid. Standing apart, the misfit in the picture is a guy in a baseball cap, clean-shaven, shirt and jacket, maybe even a tie, maybe even a virgin, and definitely clean, determined to keep his brain booze and drug-free. The guy is Steven Spielberg, fresh from his day job at Universal Studios, where he has been directing television episodes of Marcus Welby, Columbo, Night Gallery, keeping his nose to the grindstone while his contemporaries are using theirs as delivery systems. The early starter, who couldn't do sports or campfires and got his Boy Scout badge by making a movie, is probably more proficient with a camera, knows more intimately the excitement of putting shots together than a whole classroom of film school graduates. He's not crazy about working in television, but he didn't have the grades to get into the film school at USC, so he's learning to edit, developing strategies for dealing with divas, acquiring discipline. Not a top priority for this renegade crowd. They are the cool guys and visionaries, with grand plans for remaking the studio system. Coppola, born 1939, no slouch, has already made 5 films and won 3 Academy Awards by 1972, the year of The Godfather, and started Zoetrope, his own studio in 1969. George Lucas, 1944, will open a studio too. His age and career closely parallel Spielberg's, and his THX 1138, which started as a student film in 1969, blew Spielberg's mind. Paul Schrader, 1946, breaking away with a vengeance from his Calvinist upbringing, writes The Yakuza in 1974, and Taxi Driver in 1976. Martin Scorsese, 1942. NYU Film School graduate, will direct Mean Streets in 1973. Brian De Palma, 1940, begins modestly with the offbeat Greetings and Hi, Mom, and goes on to Carrie in 1976. John Milius, 1944, the tough guy of the bunch, will bring a modern intensity to action pictures. anxious studio czars still stuck in a post-war era of censorship and high-gloss stars are shaken by movies like Easy Rider, Bonnie and Clyde, The Graduate. They continue to make old-fashioned family pictures and win Oscars for movies like In the Heat of the Night and Oliver. But movies are becoming less waspy glamorous, more ethnic. Without confronting the war or the Kennedy assassination directly, the new films are seeded by that era's themes of guilt, pessimism, futility. The aesthetic is grittier, the stories often bleak or open-ended, a radical departure from the old narrative playbooks. The guys, yes, they were all guys, responsible for those game-changing films, are in love with the Nouvelle Vague, Fellini and Antonioni. Movies of the 60s like Faces, Easy Rider, and Dr. Strangelove, and Robert Altman's 1970 MASH have made the world safe for a new kind of studio-financed independent film. The new guys' collective euphoria will prove to be a media moment rather than a changing of the guard, a rejuvenation rather than a revolution. Hollywood's taste for personal directors will fade after a couple of folies de grandeur like Apocalypse Now and Michael Cimino's Heaven's Gate. Two squares from suburbia would bring Hollywood back to its comfort zone. Of course, neat divisions between hip and square, one era and another, are journalistic conveniences that conceal as much as they reveal. No less an oversimplification than the notion of a strict separation between Hollywood and independent cinema. The Monkees were as much a part of the 60s as Bob Dylan. Nevertheless, the two new Hollywoods are present on that beach, though they don't quite know it at the time. What they all have in common, along with directorial ambition, is that movies are their language, their grammar, their poetry. Their heads are filled with camera movements rather than words. They're high on the movies they will make, and their excitement is echoed by a seriousness about American films among a new breed of critics, writing in the underground and alternate weeklies, gradually migrating to the mainstream press. Unlike the others, Steven started out not as a movie buff, but a child of television. He didn't read film books or seek out revivals. His apprenticeship was strictly hands-on with a movie camera. And then, when he did begin gorging on Hollywood cinema, it was the craftsmen and the epic filmmakers to whom he was drawn. While De Palma and Scorsese, at least for the moment, are thinking small, homages to Fellini and Hitchcock, Steven imagines widescreen epics, like David Lean's Lawrence of Arabia, or, the picture that enthralled him as a child, Cecil B. DeMille's The Greatest Show on Earth. His mentor idols are not the auteurs, but journeymen like Victor Fleming and borderline auteur Michael Curtiz. While the others were cultivating their outsider status as artists, movie makers with personal visions, Spielberg, with his complex, mostly subterranean relationship with his Jewishness, wanted only to fit in. His father was a workaholic, in whose absence he had grown up in a house of free-range females, an artistically inclined permissive mother, and three high-spirited younger sisters. Even the dog, he once complained, was female. Another common thread is the male-oriented cinema, to which both the edgy and the more conventional upstarts will gravitate. These 20 and 30-somethings have grown up in the flight path of two of the greatest upheavals in history, feminism and the technological revolution. In mere seconds of evolutionary time, women had gone from winning the vote to running for office, and computers had evolved from servants to masters. Whether expressed in science fiction fantasies or toga parties, cartoon heroes or super macho action movies, male anxiety lurks ever closer to the surface. Unlike the more romantic or erotically driven cinema of path-breaking elders like Woody Allen, Paul Mazursky, John Cassavetes, Robert Altman, Arthur Penn, lovers and likers of women, these newcomers were all, in different ways, in flight from women. In the film industry, the sense of thread, from women on the one hand, and from machines and artificial intelligence on the other, will form a leitmotif that runs like a threnody through all these filmmakers' work. The male-female equilibrium, always breathtakingly precarious in, say, screwball comedies and film noir, had already begun to topple in the 50s. Spielberg would not be alone in rarely, if ever, featuring an interesting complex woman at the fore or even an adult sexual relationship. And by sexual, I don't mean specific portrayal of sex, but a feeling for the chemistry of attraction that is a sort of baseline language, not just in European films, but even, perhaps especially, in old Hollywood films. With the crumbling of taboos, love and marriage were no longer forever. Diversity of race and sexual orientation meant a dethroning of the WASP couple as the all-purpose embodiment of romantic fantasies. The nerd is preparing his revenge. As an outsider in his teenage years, both Jewish and a non-jock, Spielberg understood doubly the insecurities of the awkward adolescent, and he would tap into the vulnerability of the male in a more direct way than either Judd Apatow or the testosterone-pumped action flicks. He wasn't interested in superheroes, in outsized Hulks and Transformers, or in suavely invulnerable Bond-like protagonists. And while Apatow's schlubby antiheroes were smoking pot and ogling girls while resisting marriage and fatherhood, Spielberg, with less jaded eyes, would tap into the spirit of regression by spinning fairy tales out of infancy and youth, infusing them with a holy aura and raising them to new heights of meaning and artistic seriousness. One of the most appealing aspects of Spielberg is his disarming candor. Throughout his long career, he has known, and what's more, acknowledged, where his strengths and weaknesses lay. He didn't try for sex or for grown-up romance because he wasn't good at it, and he wasn't one of the political or lifestyle radicals. From the early age at which he began planning his career, he knew he stood on the commercial side of the split between art and commerce. "I am my audience," he would say, and this turned out to be amazingly, astoundingly, continually true as he and they aged. He could have been anticipating the split between the square and the cool at the Nicholas Beach gatherings when he told the story on himself in a short film called Amblin, made in 1968 as his calling card to the studios. I'll describe this remarkable first effort in more detail later, but suffice to say that between the two main characters, a hippie and a square, the latter is clearly and candidly the Spielberg surrogate. And the hippie girl? A nod, perhaps, to free spirits like Jennifer and Margot. But might she not also be a 60s rendition of that primal free spirit, Stephen's mother Leah, the anything-goes mom, the fairy godmother, who grants her son his every wish? She was more co-conspirator than parent, he told Leslie Stahl in 2012 on 60 Minutes. Included in the segment was a separate interview with both of his long-divorced parents, charming and seemingly congenial. "We never said no," Leah Adler confessed. "Anything he wanted, we did. Steve really did run us. He called the shots." To which Stephen added, "My mom didn't parent us as much as she sort of big-sistered us. She was Peter Pan. She refused to grow up." It was during the same interview that a revelation occurred. Contrary to the conviction, long held by Stephen and expressed in the weaker, perfidious father figures of his films, that Arnold was the culprit in the breakup, it turned out that it was Leah who strayed. Leah, the exalted one, the parent on a pedestal, had fallen in love with Arnold's good friend. Arnold conceded in the same interview that he had allowed, even encouraged, this misconception. "Why?" asked Stahl. "I don't know," Arnold says. "I think I was just protecting her because I was in love with her." "Even though she left you?" Stahl presses. "Yeah," Arnold admits with a smile. "Still do." Had Stephen ever entertained such a suspicion? Had even the vaguest idea of Leah's betrayal existed in the boy's subconscious? If so, he couldn't afford to let it emerge into full awareness. Leah was the caretaker, the heart and soul of the family. He needed for Arnold to be the fall guy, just as he needed to revere his mother as partner, liberator, and saint. For 15 years, Stephen nourished this myth of villainy and virtue, its powerful hold on his emotions triggering the imaginative configuration of every movie, every male and female character, and plot dynamic contributing to that pre-Oedipal mindset that became both inspiration and limitation. There would be more benign father figures after the revelation, but the impulses of blame and reverence and the sexual taboos that went with them would continue to animate the stories. Why would anyone want to work through or resolve such profitable anxieties? Stephen was born in Cincinnati, where Leah Posner and Arnold Spielberg had grown up, one of the great Midwestern boomtowns of the 19th century. It was a center for both industry and culture, and a magnet for immigrants. First the English and Dutch in the early part of the century, then Russian and Eastern European Jews between 1881 and 1914. It soon became home to one of the largest Jewish populations west of the Alleghenies. Leah's family, the Posners, had come from Odessa, a city of progressive ideas and cultural ferment, while Arnold's were from a rural and distinctly less worldly area of the Ukraine, Kamenets-Podolsky. There were ranchers and farmers on his father's side, brewers on his mother's side. The two areas were different in another way. Kamenets, though not untouched by pogroms, had a less violent history. For long periods, Jews and non-Jews kept to themselves in peaceful coexistence. When Jewish families finally began emigrating, they were driven by a variety of reasons, economic as well as physical. There were restrictions on Jewish labor, and the men were being forced to serve in the Tsar's army, known for its mistreatment of Jews. Odessa, however, for all its claims to cosmopolitanism, was far more riven by anti-Semitic violence. Born there in 1884, Philip Posner witnessed some of the worst anti-Jewish riots in Russian history, and finally came to America following the pogroms of 1905, the year of the sailors' mutiny on the battleship Potemkin, subject of the great Eisenstein silent film. Arriving in Cincinnati, he, like many Jews, indeed like Arnold's own father, began as a pushcart peddler and traveling salesman, eventually working out of his home. Little Stephen would spend hours in his attic playing with Philip's unsold merchandise, a cornucopia which he converted into toys. Arnold's father, who died just before Stephen was born, became a jobber, soon acquiring a store and a sales route. He eventually amassed a large sum of money, then lost it all in the Depression. But the real forces in both families, the dominant figures, were the women. As so often happened, in coming to America, the men, unable to get well-paying jobs, fell in social status, while the women took charge. Nor was this just an immigrant pattern. Even in Russia, Arnold's grandmother had worked the brewery with her sons while the father studied Torah. In each of Stephen's grandmothers, Rebecca Spielberg and Jenny Posner had been a powerhouse in her own right. In Cincinnati, they not only assumed domestic responsibilities, but spread their wings into political and community activities as well. Rebecca, Grandma Becky, was very smart, read avidly, and was active in Jewish organizations and politics while raising three bright children. Leah's mother, Jenny, the only one of Stephen's grandparents to have been born in Cincinnati, was the spark plug whose hunger for education, involvement in political activities, and distinct indifference to domesticity clearly ignited her daughter. Arnold had grown up in Avondale, a venerable Jewish neighborhood that was itself split between North, German Jews, and South, Eastern European Jews. There were non-Jews in Avondale, but by a kind of tacit mutual agreement, both sides kept their distance. The most severe prejudice Arnold remembered experiencing as a child was from German Jews, who thought themselves superior, socially, culturally, and financially. It was in Avondale's Adath Israel synagogue that he and Leah were married. The year was 1945, the end of the war, just before he was demobilized from the U.S. Army. A little over a year later, on December 18, 1946, Stephen was born in Avondale's non-sectarian Jewish hospital, and it was in Avondale that the Spielbergs, surrounded by extended family, lived for the first 2.5 years of Stephen's life. Their part of Avondale was mostly middle-aged and older Orthodox Jews, so Stephen spent his infancy in a strange sort of cocoon, a beloved child among much older people with few children his own age. His father was attending the University of Cincinnati on the GI Bill and burning the midnight oil, while Stephen was entrusted to his mother and a circle of grown-ups. As grandmother Jenny, Leah's mother, taught English out of her home to German-Jewish immigrants, so at an early age the little boy heard tales of Hitler and the Holocaust, even witnessed tattoos on survivors' arms. Cincinnati, a locus of the tensions and possibilities of modern Judaism, would take on a progressive cast with the arrival of Rabbi Isaac Meir Weiss, an immigrant from Moravia to New York and one of the great luminaries of Reform Judaism. The sometimes controversial organizer and unifier had fled Albany after a fistfight with his synagogue's president. He now set about trying to bring cohesion to the many warring forms of religious practice, and under his influence, Cincinnati introduced pioneering institutions like Hebrew Union College, the American Israelite newspaper, and the American Jewish archives. It was also where the 8-day festival of Hanukkah, never a holy feast and barely observed by most of the Jews of the world, would become a contender with Christmas, a bonanza of gift-giving and singing concerts and celebratory activities. A perfect emblem of the contradictions in Cincinnati's version of 20th-century Judaism was that thoroughly modern Jenny's husband, Philip, was devoutly and intransigently traditional. Technically, both Posners, though they went to a conservative synagogue, were Orthodox. But Philip alone wore the Orthodox garb, a long beard, black coat, hat, and prayer shawl. And in this pioneering city of reform, he spoke Yiddish and used his Yiddish name, Feivel, refusing to modernize in any way. At the same time, he was a great performer, the singer and storyteller of the family. Leah, who knew whereof she spoke, called him a frustrated artist. The Spielberg living room would become a stage. Spiel, in German, means play. In addition to Leah at the piano and Feivel singing and dancing, there might also be a solo turn by Great Uncle Boris, Feivel's brother, who had worked briefly as a lion tamer in the circus, a Shakespearean actor in the Yiddish theater, and a vaudevillian complete with straw hat and cane. To round out the jackpot of showbiz genes to which Stephen was heir, Arnold was no mean storyteller himself. But it was Feivel, who was like the Chagall image of Shlomo Elchaim, the fiddler, who held everyone spellbound with his music and his portraits of shtetl life in extremis, the joys of community, celebrated in songs and prayer, and the terrors of pogroms. Despite the progressive atmosphere of mid-century Cincinnati, Avondale itself was an enclave, culturally advanced but, in Leah's mind, claustrophobic. Once again, the Jews had created their own city within a city, with their own schools, rituals, religion, and neighborhoods. The strategy, now instinctive, that had sheltered and protected them through the repeated adversities of history. Now, though, the worst had happened. The worst that so many had known, feared, sensed would happen. And after it, the atmosphere seemed to have changed. In America, newly aware of Hitler's atrocities would be more welcoming. Social advancement seemed possible. And as part of a reverse migration, many second-generation Jews would want to put the Holocaust behind them, strike out and brave the perils of the non-Jewish world for a chance at joining the burgeoning middle class. Leah, a born adventurer, impatient with labels and ghettos, would be among the assimilationists. Her appetite for freedom included a longing to eat what she wanted. Like recidivist dieters, she and Arnold would go on and off keeping kosher. Meet other kinds of people. Live a life unrestricted by religious constraints. She would even drop Leah for the more ambiguous nickname, Lee. When they moved to New Jersey, Stephen would take with him haunting memories, sensations capable of transubstantiation into indelible images. Biographers and reporters have relayed memories Spielberg is said to have had from this period, but it's virtually impossible for a toddler of less than 2 to form such memories. More likely, his parents told him vivid stories about his early years, and the ones he retained are those that fit in with his emerging storytelling self. This kind of narrative reworking of pre-verbal sensation provides the double vision of films like the animated movie An American Tale and its sequel, Feivel Goes West, in which Holocaust imagery and reverberations play out in a children's story. Rightly, much has been made of the importance of the recurring light shows in his movies, a primal scene cited by biographers as the seed image of his later work occurred when the 6-month-old toddler was taken by his parents to the Adath synagogue for a service with Hasidic elders and first laid eyes on the Ark of the Torah. He described the dazzling experience, a sudden blast of red light and sound seemingly of supernatural origin, in a 1985 interview with Richard Corliss of Time magazine as his earliest memory, occurring in 1948. In fact, it would have been 1947, but at the time of the interview, Spielberg was still passing off his birth year as 1947. Aware of precocious geniuses like Orson Welles, he'd begun crafting his own legend at an early age. He wanted to direct his first film before he was 21. Joseph McBride, in his invaluable biography, describes the scene in exquisite detail. Framed by a marble arch, inlaid with gold and blue, a red light burning in front of it, the Ark's wooden doors hidden by a curtain shimmering in candlelight. On high, a bronze chandelier hangs from the domed skylight, and from it a Star of David. All around, the elders sway and chant rhythmically. As beautiful as it sounds to our comprehending minds, it must also have been terrifying to this tiny infant. The sheer hugeness and brightness, the spooky elders, the mournful sounds, all contributing to one of those unbearably intense moments that a child experiences, but with no concept, no words, no meaning to tame it. For all we know, that Ark may have triggered a primal anxiety attack, its unappeased fears as crucial to future films as images of transcendence. Think of the lurid spirits that emerge from the coveted Ark at the end of the first Indiana Jones film, rotting, fanged creatures who inflict spectacularly hideous deaths on everyone but Indian Marion. This little boy, though, seems to have possessed to an extraordinary, even an unsettling degree, what scientists describe as emotional memory enhanced by anxiety. The boy in the man, a Proust with a Steadicam, manages to retain the wonder while gaining mastery of the fear. The Ark in its fearful glory will have an amazing plasticity through all his metaphoric reworkings, a call to transcendence that speaks in a universal language to audiences of every nation, tribe, and religion. Chapter 2. Steve Bites His Nails and Hears Voices. In 1949, in a move for which Leia, a.k.a. Lee, was indirectly responsible, the family relocated to New Jersey, where Arnold had been hired by RCA to work at its manufacturing plant in Camden. Having failed to win a college scholarship after high school, he might never have tried again, but Leah, believing in his talent, had persuaded him to apply to the University of Cincinnati on the GI Bill after he finished his military service. He attended night school and won his engineering degree, and now a childhood fascination with mechanics and then electronics was paying off. Instead of going into television work as he'd expected, he was assigned to work in military electronics, in circuit development within the new field of computer technology, where transistors were beginning to replace magnetics. His timing was perfect. Because of the heating up of competition with the Soviet Union, the barriers against Jews in science and higher education were falling, and RCA chairman David Sarnoff was one of the few Jews in the upper echelons of business. Another was the communications mogul William Paley, also of Ukrainian descent. It was the post-war Eisenhower years, and everybody had to own a house and a car and a television. In 1949, the Spielbergs got their first television set, and Steven's first sister, Anne, was born on Christmas Day. In 1952, the family moved from Camden to the slightly more upscale suburb of Haddon Township, where they stayed until moving to Arizona in 1957. In both places, Stephen would feel like an outsider. It would be worse in ex-suburban Phoenix, but he was already showing plenty of anxiety and nervousness. Haddon Township was a mixed neighborhood, unlike the adjacent Haddon, which was restricted to Gentiles. The township was populated by Protestants, Catholics, and even a few Jews, but his own block, Crystal Terrace, was mostly Christian. Stephen was full of mischief and curiosity, but also resentments. He lived in a household of women. His mother held all-woman concerts in her living room, and his three sisters, also beneficiaries of Leah's hands-off parenting style, just kept coming and coming. "I had to assert myself," he told Andy Warhol in the 1982 interview on Warhol's TV show, in which he complained about the dog being female. Like any male outnumbered and on the defensive, he turned torturer, and his favorite prey was, naturally, the opposite sex, starting with his sisters. A favorite trick was to lock them in a closet, then thrust in their faces a plastic skull with a flashlight inside. As he escalated to female targets in the neighborhood, Leah would merely shrug.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.